Welcome to Real Estate Roundup. My name is Emmanuel Romanis. We have a great show for you today. And as always, before we get started, if you want to contact the show, you simply send an email to realestateroundup@outlook.com. Email box is getting full again. So anytime you want to contact us, whether you have a question, if you have a comment, if you have a suggestion, if you have a complaint, whatever the case may be, I read them all. So feel free to just shoot us an email at realestateroundup@outlook.com. Now, let me share with you before we begin my morning ritual. I go out every morning to get the paper. And a couple days ago, I was walking down my long driveway to pick up the newspaper. And I noticed in one of the corners of my driveway, I have a concrete driveway, it was starting to sink a little bit. And I thought, oh, geez, driveway's probably, I don't know, maybe 10, 11 years old. And I thought, man, you know, I really don't want to have to put a new driveway in again, or at least replace a slab. It's just a pain in the rear end, and I just don't want to deal with the hassle right now. I learned, however, through a friend of mine that there is a company, and there is probably more than one, but the company that he told me about, called A1 Concrete Leveling, will actually come out and they have a process where they can level your driveway. And I'm not sure how it works, but you know, they don't have to rip out the pad. They don't have to rip out the whole driveway. They can come in and squirt something underneath the driveway to actually raise the pad up and make it level again. I was so intrigued by this that I contacted the company, and we're going to have the owner, Ryan Perkins, join us a little bit later on to explain exactly how this is done, what it is, and I hope you find it as fascinating as I do, because I didn't know anything like this ever existed. I was always under the impression, you know, when your driveway starts to sink, you have to rip out the pad and pour a whole new pad. Apparently, that is not the case. So we're going to have Ryan join us in a little bit. But before that, we're going to get to our segment called Who Knew? Today's segment is a rather simple question. What is an effective, inexpensive, and environmentally friendly way to remove dried paint from hardwood floors? The answer when we come back. Stick around.
BPTV, come volunteer.
If it wasn't fun, I wouldn't be here.
TV. Come on in, make a show. It's still fun after all these years.
From a very young age, I was exposed to sports in a great way. My uncle was on the first pro basketball team in Pittsburgh, the Pittsburgh Ironmen. And my dad, of course, that was my hero. He was a basketball referee for over 30 years. Just been a passion in my life. And as I got older, I found out about horses, and I ended up owning a stable. And I was asked to be on a sports show with Roger Houston called the Meadows Racing Network. And when we were done, I said, boy, that'd be something great. Maybe someday I could have a TV show. Back in 2011, I had a conversation with some friends about sports that piqued my interest in how could we start a sports talk show on TV? Well, I found out I could go to public access TV in Bethel Park and I'd be able to produce my own sports talk TV show. The great thing about doing two sports talk shows on BPTV is I can share my passion about sports with thousands of people every week. If you are passionate about something that you would like to share with the community, I encourage you to come to BPTV and produce a show like I do. I'm Al Levine, volunteer producer of Pittsburgh Sportsline on BP TV.
Welcome back. Before the break, we posed the question of what is an effective, inexpensive, and environmentally friendly way to remove dried paint from hardwood floors. The reason why this question even came up on this segment is now that my kids are gone, my wife says, hey, pull up all the carpets, let's go back to the hardwood floors in all the bedrooms. Well, when I did that, I noticed that there was a lot of paint. I guess when I painted back then, I dripped a lot, and I just figured it's going to be covered by carpet, so who cares? So I didn't want to use chemicals, and I didn't want to ruin the floor, and what I discovered is rubbing alcohol works wonders. A little bit of elbow grease and just plain rubbing alcohol will take that dried paint right up, and the floor looks good as new. So who knew? Okay, joining me now, as I mentioned earlier in the program, is Ryan Perkins. He is the owner of A1 Concrete Leveling. Ryan, welcome to the program.
Thank you.
Let's start with the basics. A1 Concrete Leveling, what is it and how did you get started?
Yeah, so A1 Concrete Leveling is a foundation repair company.
Okay.
And what we do mainly is address settling concrete. So settling concrete slabs, we address those through the foundation of the concrete itself.
Okay.
So a lot of times what will happen is you have a drainage issue or settlement because of earth being moved.
Mm-hmm.
That creates a void underneath the concrete.
Right.
And what we do is drill a 1-inch hole underneath or through the slab.
Okay.
And inject a limestone-based grout underneath the concrete, fills any type of void, pressurizes, and raises the concrete back up.
Oh, okay. So in a case where you have a concrete driveway and part of it is starting to drop, you can just get underneath it and literally just lift it back up to make it level.
That's right. We're going to reestablish the base and raise the concrete in order to eliminate any trip hazard.
That's amazing. How long does that process normally take?
That's a little bit dependent on the surface area, the amount of space we're dealing with.
Right, right.
I would say most jobs are done in an afternoon.
Oh, really? That quick?
Yeah.
Okay. And as far as, can it be done with any size area, or are you limited as to the area size that something like that will work on?
When you say area size, are you...
Well, for example, if I have a driveway that's 500 feet and 200 feet of that is starting to sink.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, there's no problem with this. What we're going to do, we're going to take the material that you would put underneath your driveway if you were to build it new.
Right.
And we're going to have that ground to a finer dust.
Okay.
So limestone is angular. It has bonding characteristics.
Okay.
And we're going to take that, pump that underneath the concrete. So it's going to be a bit finer,
mm-hmm.
but there's no reason why you can't have a large amount of that, if that's what you're saying, or a long
right.
distance. Or, you know, one of the unique things about this process versus, say, tearing out is that we can get to areas without disrupting stuff too much. So if you have a 500-foot driveway that's difficult to access,
right?
You know, we can access that with long hoses, a couple hundred feet of hose.
Now, does it matter as far as the thickness of the driveway? Because I know the way they pour them, some of them you'll find are 6 inches, some are 8, some are 4. Does that matter with your process, or?
It doesn't.
Okay.
No, we've done airport runway slabs.
Oh, okay.
Those are over 18 inches thick.
It works with a concrete driveway for
yeah.
all practical purposes.
Absolutely.
Okay. Now, when you pour the limestone in or inject it in, and I may be using the wrong terminology, is that liquefied or how?
Yeah.
What's the texture of it?
So on the back of our truck, it's a dry material that we're putting in the back.
Okay.
And then we have a mixing station on the back that where we're going to we're going to choose the consistency that we're looking for.
Okay.
So we're usually looking for what I would say is like a thick milkshake.
Oh, okay. All right.
So it's going to be flowable, but it's not going to be runny.
Okay. And then obviously once that gets in, it'll harden.
It will.
And okay. Now, what is the typical, and I know weather and other factors enter into that, but typically once you do this process, how long will it last?
There's no reason why it shouldn't last for as long. I mean, as long as the drainage issue is taken care of.
Right, right, of course.
Right, so nothing's going to wash the material away.
Right.
And the settlement itself is done for the most part.
Okay.
Usually that's about a 13-year process. If it's a, say, a new home, new driveway, running into problems, it seems to be between 8 and 13 years to where that reaches its end.
Okay.
But for the most part, this is a permanent process. I mean,
okay.
you're reestablishing the base with the same material you were going to build it with.
Got it. Okay. Now, can this be done multiple times? So let's say, you know, you come out and raise my driveway today. In 15 years, it sags again, and probably by that time, I'm going to need a whole new driveway. But to play devil's advocate.
Sure.
Can you come out and redo the process, or is it kind of a one-time shot?
No, we can absolutely redo the process.
Okay, so it can be done over and over.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, it's going to move with the soil. So
okay.
It's not going to stay independent of the soil, and it's not going to attach itself to the slab itself.
Okay.
So really, there should be no reason you would ever have to replace your driveway.
All right.
I mean, there's driveways that are 30 years old that we've done in the first year. I mean, we don't do them again.
Right.
But it's only if there's nothing that's causing that to settle.
That's very interesting. So actually, if it doesn't attach, then it sounds like you're actually laying a separate base underneath that the original driveway is setting on top of.
That's
basically right.
Yeah.
Man, that's amazing. How did you come up with the process, or how did you get involved in a business like this?
Yeah, so I grew up in Ohio, and mm-hmm. my father ran into this business when I was in the military out
okay.
in California, and he was an engineer for a steel mill.
Oh, okay.
And he had an opportunity to take a severance mm-hmm. and had been looking at some businesses, thought he wanted to do something. Ran into A1. They actually started out of Akron, Ohio.
Oh, okay.
So he had found the inventor mm-hmm. and worked with him. And Grover Miller, the inventor, had started on large projects mm-hmm. in a massive scale with the Army Corps of Engineers.
Okay.
And his idea was to take it and be able to use this on a much smaller scale. So something that could be brought into a residential environment.
Okay, so this process has been around, sounds like it's been around a long time, and it's tried and true.
It is. Yeah.
That's fantastic. Now I understand you also do foundations where wall bowing and things of that nature. You can correct that as well.
Yes.
Now, what I'm familiar with, and this is new to me, and that's one of the reasons I wanted to have you on the show, was to learn more about it, because I find the process just fascinating. Typically, when you hear of a bowing wall, you think of wall anchors or wall straps. When you're fixing a bowing wall, do you do the similar type thing, or is your process different from those?
Our process is different. We do straps if it's necessary when
okay.
we cannot access something like this, a carbon fiber strapping system possibly.
Yeah. Yeah.
Is that one you're familiar
yeah.
with?
Yeah, yes.
Okay. So what we would do in 95% of the cases where this is accessible on a standard block wall
mm-hmm.
Is we're going to drill 1-inch holes in the top of the block.
Mm-hmm.
And, excuse me, we're going to drill 1-inch holes in this, well, we're going to, it depends on the scenario. Let me
right.
ask you. So if we, depending on access for the wall,
okay.
We're going to insert 3/8 rebar the length of that wall.
Okay, got
okay,
it.
Okay, so that may, if it has to be, if it can only be accessed from the inside, the process
right.
changes a little bit.
Right.
If it's accessed from the outside, it's a little bit more convenient for us.
Right.
So we would drill into the top block of the wall, insert 3/8 rebar down the length of the block.
Okay.
Every 16 inches, we're putting rebar.
Okay.
And then we pump the wall solid with a Portland limestone grout.
Okay. All right, so it's the same type of pour that you're using outside on the driveway that you're using for the foundation, or similar?
It's similar. We're using the aggregate, and we're adding Portland cement to it.
Okay, got it. Okay. Yeah. Now, will that bring the wall back in line, or does that simply prevent it from moving further?
So that's freezing the wall in place.
Okay.
At that point. So if you have stress cracks,
right,
and you're concerned about a drainage issue, or you know we have a lot of clay in this area,
right,
it doesn't drain very well, causes pressure on the wall.
Right.
So you're noticing that, then freezing the wall in place is probably the thing to do.
Okay.
If the wall has bowed beyond, say, 2 inches,
right,
you know, that's probably going to have to be excavated out, pushed back straight,
okay,
and then filled and strengthened.
Okay. Now, as far as, and again, that process that you just mentioned to me is new to me. Probably been around for 100 years, but I've never heard of it before. How does that compare cost-wise to, say, the carbon fiber straps? Is it comparable, a little bit more, a little bit less?
If you're freezing the wall in place, I would say it's probably less.
Okay.
If you're having to excavate and remove all that soil, I mean, there's
right,
there's a whole nother project,
sure,
that's pretty much put on top of that. But yeah, it's very, very, very comparable.
Okay. Now, you're the only company that I've heard that does that as far as freezing the wall. Do other companies do that, or is that proprietary to you guys?
Well, what helps us is we can pump our grout through a 1-inch hose.
Oh, okay. Really? Just a 1-inch hose?
A 1-inch hose.
That's amazing. And
sometimes we get it down to 5/8.
Wow. That's amazing. Okay.
So, but it's a 1-inch hose that we may reduce.
Okay.
Yeah.
Jeez, a whiz. That is phenomenal. Now, how long has A1 has been around for a long time as far as your company, and I understand you and your father own it, correct?
That's correct.
Okay, how long have you guys been around?
We've been around, he's been with the company for 18 years.
Oh, okay.
And I've been for 14.
Okay, and you handle the entire southern Pennsylvania area, or
so
where will you go?
Right, so I manage western Pennsylvania.
Okay.
So we have an Erie branch, and then we have Pittsburgh itself, and we started out just up in Cranberry,
okay,
and then have expanded to, well, there was another owner, mm-hmm, down here, and he had gotten older and decided he wanted out, and
right,
so we took the opportunity and applied our methods in this region as well.
That is fantastic. Anything else that you think is relevant that I haven't asked, or you'd like to bring up that you think would be relevant to the viewers?
Well, you know, drainage issues cause a lot of these problems. So
okay,
identifying those problems is one thing that we try to focus on.
Okay.
So correcting the issue at the source is something that we're trying to accomplish.
Okay.
So it's more than just dealing with the issue that you're bringing up, say the trip,
right,
hazard. It's more about addressing the foundation issue, and that's one of the reasons we would call ourselves a foundation repair company.
Okay.
Is because we feel like we're addressing it at its root.
So you want to keep the drainage, obviously, keep the water away from the foundation, whether it's, you know, rerouting the gutters or the landscaping, having it slope properly away from the house. Keep the water away from the house is the key.
For sure.
Okay. Now, as far as I know that you work primarily, maybe exclusively, with concrete driveways. Do you do any type of work with asphalt driveways?
We really don't.
Okay. That's a whole different animal.
It is. The asphalt doesn't, you know, it doesn't have the same binding that the concrete has. So
okay.
It will bend, whereas concrete will not bend.
Okay.
Concrete's going to crack. If you have a bow in concrete and you don't recognize it,
mm-hmm,
there's a crack there.
Okay, got it. Now, do you get involved at all? Let's say my driveway is just beyond repair, and I just want to rip it out and put a whole new driveway in. Do you handle that as well, or are you simply on the repair end of it?
Well, usually what we're doing is we're working with other contractors. Sometimes we can save a customer money,
okay,
where we're able to implement our process and then refer a reputable contractor that we feel like is going to do a good job for them.
Oh, okay.
We try to stay local. Right. So wherever we're working that day, we're a bit of a niche, so we're kind of spread around a little bit.
Okay.
But we'll try and work with a local contractor.
Okay, good deal. That is fascinating stuff. I want to thank you for coming. I appreciate your time. A1 Concrete Leveling, Mr. Ryan Perkins. You need foundation work. You need your driveway leveled. You need some information on keeping water away from the foundation. These are the guys to call. We'll be right back.
Distracted driving has been called an epidemic. Unfortunately, many of us drive distracted. So what is distracted driving?
It is driving while engaged in any activity that could divert a person's attention away from the prime task of driving.
Texting, making phone calls, putting on makeup, reaching for objects, changing the CD or radio channel is part of an endless list that put us at risk. The following statistics should make each of us think about making changes in the way we drive or ride in a car. In 2012, over 3,000 people were killed and 421,000 were injured as a result of distracted driving.
In 2011, it was estimated that a typical daylight moment, at least 660,000 cars were being driven by drivers using handheld cell phones.
40% of teenagers have been in a car with a person using a cell phone while driving in a way that put others in danger. Driving while using a cell phone reduces the amount of brain activity devoted to driving by 37%.
Change the way you drive. Speak up for your safety.
Drive without texting or talking on your cell phone. Make calls or texts prior to driving. Pull over to a safe location to text or check emails. Stop texting or talking on cell phones to others that are driving. It all starts with you.
I think film and television in general is a very discouraging industry. It takes a lot of years of pounding the pavement, calling people, finding your ends. You're gonna carry a lot of heavy cable, get dirty a lot, and find your way in. With the limited amount of resources out there and the limited amount of opportunities, there's a fantastic resource right here. And it's public access, it's free of charge. Anybody can come in and gain that experience. Dave absolutely loves to help people, you know, never said no to us growing up. Anything we wanted to do, we were able to do here. The first year I was here, I would just sign on for different projects, like Stump the Students was a show that I worked on quite frequently. It was a game show. We would just come up with our own little ideas, mostly sketches, a lot of school projects, a lot of classes when we'd have to do a project on a story we read or something like that. I would always ask if we could do a video as our project instead, and we would typically do it through Dave. You know, one of my favorite things we did was one of the simplest things we did. It was put together in an afternoon. It was something we wanted to do for fun. We were playing around learning Final Cut Pro, learning how to do linear editing, and we decided to do something in reverse. So we filmed me, actually, I think it was, running around the building out here, jumping off walls backwards, running around backwards, and played the whole thing in reverse. It was really simple. It was, you know, corny. We just did it for fun, but for a couple weeks after that, people kept coming up to me at school like, well, how'd you do that? We were more exposed to our student body than we felt we were, not having an association with any extracurriculars of the school. It was fun to see how, even though we were doing it on our own, it was still making its reach to Bethel Park, and it was still something that we were getting feedback for, positive feedback from, and that was really nice. I would say the BPTV is one of the greatest creative resources this community has, and I would absolutely encourage anyone with any interest in production to come here and learn from Dave and take their ideas and turn them into something. If I hadn't been here at BPTV, I wouldn't have advanced at the rate I did in my industry. I wouldn't have had the passion for my industry nurtured the way it was here. I don't think that I would have pursued it because I don't think I would have had as clear a picture of what was available to me in this industry unless I had come here and gotten that firsthand experience prior to having to make the decisions that you have to make whenever you're graduating from high school. Opportunity really only comes to people who establish a lifestyle to seize it. And this is the kind of place where you can seize an opportunity and change what you want your future to be.
Okay, welcome back. Well, I hope you find that fascinating. I want to thank Ryan Perkins again for joining me. As I had mentioned earlier in the show, I never knew that a process like this existed as far as correcting a sinking driveway. And you know, I just find the whole engineering side of it just fascinating. And I hope you find it informative and fascinating as well. We're going to dip into the mailbag. We have a little bit of time left. And this segment's or this show's mailbag comes from Randy from Bethel Park. And he asks, I lease an apartment which has become uninhabitable due to gross landlord neglect. Do I have any recourse to get out of my lease? Well, that's a great question, Randy. And the first thing that I have to advise is any type of legal issue like this, you really need to seek the counsel of a qualified attorney. However, what I can share with you is in Pennsylvania, they have what is called a warranty of habitability. And basically what that states is if a tenant can prove that the premises is not fit for habitation, the court can order a reduction or cessation of rental payment. And that is called the warranty of habitability. Now again, you need to really seek the counsel of a qualified attorney as to what recourse you have, what remedies you may have, if any. But that is something that is in effect in the state of Pennsylvania, the warranty of habitability. Okay, with that, in closing, I got a lot of, and I want to mention this because I'm really tickled pink by it. I got a lot of emails for our show with Bethel Bakery. As I had mentioned during the show, and everybody knows, Bethel Bakery is a longtime mainstay in the South Hills area, and a lot of people really seem to enjoy that show. And I'm glad of that. I'm glad that you enjoyed it. I'm glad that it made you watch. Maybe it was because the Bethel Bakery is so beloved in the South Hills area. But thank you for reaching out. Thank you for letting me know that it is something that you did enjoy. I enjoyed the interview as well. And hopefully we'll be able to bring more things like that to you that are more ingrained in the South Hills and Bethel Park area. So with that, as always, that's a wrap. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time.
Νύχτωσες τη νύχτα μου, νύχτωσες και μένα.